Welcome to Cherry Girlfriends Church. Today is Sunday, November 27th, 2022.
All right, all together now. The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And as everyone knows, the Catholic Church means the universal church.
Isaiah chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. This is what Isaiah son of Amoz saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and all nations will stream to it. Many people will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his paths. The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Come, descendants of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord." So we should walk in the light of the Lord. So this week is the beginning of the Advent season. I know it's still November, but we're going to do Christmas songs. And we're going to talk about Jesus. Well, we talk about Jesus every week, but we're going to talk about Jesus in the Advent season. So this morning, we're going to, before the service, I was like, who can I have light the Advent candle? I'm going to have someone come up and light it. And then I was informed that it has batteries. So I'm really glad I didn't set it on fire. That would have would have been really awkward. Anyway, we have an Advent wreath up here. And if you don't know the story of the Advent wreath, it actually began as a catechism, a way of teaching children in the Lutheran tradition about the Advent. Now, it wasn't the Advent of Christmas. It was the Advent of Christ's return. So what we celebrate in the Advent season, it has become over time about Christmas and the birth of Jesus long ago. But Advent is actually an anticipation both of what has already happened and of what will happen. So there's an Advent in the past and there's an Advent in the future. And we're going to be looking at both throughout the next 4 weeks as we head up to Christmas Eve. That there's what has been done, there is what is being done, and there is what will be done. So our anticipation is for all of those. And this morning I'm going to do a liturgical reading. It's call and response that will be up on the screen. The bold parts you guys will read. I will read the not bold parts. And this is actually a liturgy to mark the beginning of the Christmas season that is for a family. But you know what? We are family enough, guys. We are family enough. A liturgy to mark the beginning of the Christmas season. As we prepare our house for the coming Christmas season, we would also prepare our hearts for the returning Christ. Though there was no room at the inn to receive you upon your first arrival, as we decorate and celebrate, we do so to mark the memory of your redemptive movement into our broken world, O God. Our glittering ornaments and Christmas trees, our festive carols, our sumptuous feasts. That God, on a particular night, in a particular place, so many years ago, was born to us. Our wreaths and ribbons and colored lights, our giving of gifts, our parties with friends, these have never been ends in themselves. They are but small ways in which we repeat. In the skies near Bethlehem. In view of such great tidings of love announced, as we decorate our tree and as we feast and laugh and sing together, we are rehearsing our coming joy. We are making ready to receive the one who has already, with open arms, received us. Now we celebrate your first coming, Emmanuel, even as we long for your return. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. It's a beautiful thing for me to hear your voices reflecting back, that it's not just me talking, but I get to hear you. So thank you. You know, go ahead and put the next slide up there. John 14:18, there is assurance that Jesus, our elder brother, will in fact return. And the great hope that we anticipate is found in this statement that he has left for us. In his address to his disciples, he said, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. So as we celebrate the past and that the coming of Jesus has happened, we should also anticipate and celebrate the certain future. That Jesus Christ has come, is coming, and will come. He will not leave us as orphans. He will come to us. Your elder brother, the King of Kings, once born in Bethlehem and laid in a manger, will not leave you here alone. His promises are sure. His power is infinite, and his love commensurate with it. This is your hope, and there is no other hope.
Romans 13:11-14. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh.
Amen. Thank you all for sharing what's on your hearts, for the things you have seen, the joys, the suffering, the difficulties, all of those things. And keep it up, because you can share those things not just here. You can share them with one another throughout the week, throughout this holiday season, after church. Go to lunch with somebody. Talk about what you're seeing in your life. Do I tell you guys to go have lunch with each other often enough? Like, okay, I just want to make sure that I'm really clear on that. Like, that's, yeah, okay. Yeah. Sorry. Where am I? We're moving towards the center of our worship service. I know I say this every week, but this is the core of what we do. So we fill ourselves with the community of the saints, with the word of God in scripture, with prayer for one another and for the things we see around us, worship in song, all of those things. That's all culminating in our time of open worship, where we sit and listen for the Spirit of God to speak to us. So I put in the bulletin this week some Advent-themed queries. I didn't put them up here. They're in the sheet, and they're not just for today. They're things to consider about how you might prepare yourself for this Advent season, this season of anticipation of what is coming. And I know, I mean, I worked retail for years. I know that the holiday season is often busy. It's often overwhelming. You often have a lot of things going on in your life. Family is a blessing. Family can also be a lot of work. So I think it's very important for us as believers in Jesus to spend the beginning of this season preparing our hearts to keep him at the center. Because it can be very easy for that to get sort of washed out by all the other stuff going on. So how do you prepare your heart for Christ to remain at the center of your anticipation, in both the past anticipation of Christ who has come and the future anticipation of Christ who will come? So we're going to read Psalm 122. We're going to sing some songs. I'm going to say a word about these songs, actually, because they're four of my favorite songs. We have O Come, Emmanuel, which is probably the oldest song that you will ever sing in church. It's been around a very, very long time. Started as a Gregorian chant. It came upon a midnight clear, which is a 16th century English bar tune that got rewritten into a Christmas song. I heard the bells on Christmas Day. If you don't know the story behind that, it was written by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow on Christmas, less than a month after his wife was killed in a house fire, and his son was what it turned out eventually to be a fatal injury during the Civil War. And if you listen to the lyrics or sing the lyrics of that song, there is a journey. There's a journey in that in the music there. And the last one is a song that it's the best Christmas song you've never heard. Glory Be to God on High is a song by Charles Wesley. I didn't know it until a week ago. I don't know. I guess, 6,000 Wesley hymns, I'm not going to know them all. But that one I'd never heard, and I'm like, man, it's really good. So anyway, enough hymnology. Let's read together Psalm 122. And let's all read this together aloud. I rejoiced with those who said to me, "Let us go up to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing in your gates, Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built like a city that is closely compacted together. That is where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to praise the name of the Lord, according to the statute given to Israel. There stand the thrones for judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you be secure. May there be peace within your walls and security within your citadels. For the sake of my family and friends, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your prosperity.
Thank you. thy Lord of might, who to thy tribes on Sinai's height in ancient times didst give the law in cloud and majesty.
Splendors flee, and the
I heard the bells on Christmas Day. They're all familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And thought how as the day had come, the belfries of our Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Till ringing, singing on its way, the world from night to day, a voice, a chime, a chant sublime of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men. Glory be to God on high, and peace on earth descend. God comes down, he bows the sky, and shows himself our friend. God the invisible appears, God the blessed, the great I am, sojourns in this veil of tears, and Jesus is his name. Him the angels all adore, their maker and their king. Tidings of their humble Lord they now to mortals bring, emptied of his majesty, of his dazzling glory short, being source begins to be, and God himself is born. eternal Son of God, a mortal Son of Man, dwelling in an earthly cloud. Heaven cannot contain. Stand amazed, ye heavens, at this. See the Lord of earth and skies, humble to the dust he is, and in a manger sons of men rejoice, the Prince of Peace proclaim, with the angels lift up your voice, and shout Emmanuel's name, knees and hearts to him we bow, of our flesh and of our bone, Jesus is our brother now, and God is all our own.
Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we ask you humbly as we come before you to teach us the things that you would have us learn, that you would create in us the people that you would have us be, that you would show us the ways to walk that we cannot see for ourselves. You have given us your word as a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. I pray now that you would open up our hearts to that word and show us the ways in which we should go. Open up your word to us that we may see the things that you would reveal. And Lord God, I pray that we would continue to do that every day as we walk with you, to see the doors you are closing, the doors you are opening, the ways that you would have us work for your kingdom in this time, in this place. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, amen. So, I've threatened it a number of times. I'm going to preach a genealogy. I know. This first Sunday of Advent, the theme is hope. There's four themes in the Advent season. This one's hope. And it turns out that the genealogy that opens the book of Matthew is actually a theme of hope. Because as we saw, as we left off a couple of weeks ago, going through the narrative end of the Old Testament, that there wasn't actually a whole lot of hope tied up in the people of God at the end of the book of Nehemiah. You actually have Nehemiah as kind of the last leader of the people of God, ending with desperation, of saying, I did my best, I'm out. Like, God remember me for all I tried to do. And for several hundred years, the people of God persisted in that mode of, where's our leader? Who will lead us into the promises that God has made for thousands of years to our ancestors? Where will we find our Savior? And then the book of Matthew is the opening of the New Testament. And Matthew was written particularly to the Jewish people. So the people who had all of this material from the Old Testament in their minds and in their hearts just dug into their souls. It was their national story. And he opens with a family tree. Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. This is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Amminadab, Amminadab the father of Nahshon, Nahshon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab, Boaz the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth, Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. If by chance someone asks you about baby names, don't forget things like Ram and Amminadab. Can we bring those back? No? No? All right. So on Friday, this last Friday, after a walk down to the local Fred Meyer to buy gloves, because that's what you do the day after Thanksgiving, apparently, Laura Lee and I decorated the house. So many of you may have this tradition as well, that day after Thanksgiving is when you pull out the Christmas decorations. You put together the artificial tree because you're allergic to pine and fir trees. Oh, no, that's me, not you, but that's what we do. And of course, I had to run back to the store because two strands of lights had stopped working, which is also part of Christmas tradition, right? Your lights quit. And while I was gone, Laura Lee did this like magic thing at the house where fall went away and Christmas showed up. I love it because it's the kind of thing I have no sense for at all, none. But I love it when I walk in the door and I'm like, oh, it's Christmas now. Look at that. How'd that happen? It's lovely. And you know what? This year, for years, I have wanted a Christmas train. Like, my grandfather worked on the railroad. He was a railroad man. And I love trains. I've always loved trains. And one of you out there got rid of a bunch of Christmas stuff this last year. And one of the things you got rid of was some Christmas train ornaments. So I got to put my little Christmas train on one of these floating shelves, and I felt so good. It was like, oh, I have a Christmas train. It was awesome. I really love Christmas trains. It was so cool. Anyway, we get the house decorated, and then after decorating the house, we went on a walk again because I can't sit still for that long. And then we sat down with hot apple cider and watched the Rick Steves European Christmas special on YouTube. And this has become a tradition. We now do this every year, and I have a feeling we're going to do it for a very long time, or as long as it's available on YouTube. It's a tradition. And by the way, that show, European Christmas, is all about traditions. European Christmas traditions in various places. Historical events, connections of one generation to another, whole towns turning out for holiday practices that run back hundreds or sometimes like thousands of years. Tree lightings, holiday markets, Christmas carols, you know, the stuff that we do too, that we build this thing we call culture. Traditions. Now, here in the United States, our traditions are all relatively new. Our Rick Steves Christmas special tradition is actually only a couple years old. But in many parts of the world, there are deep traditions that run back generation after generation, sometimes so far back that no one's actually sure when it started. It kind of just happened. And no one was keeping track of why they were doing it. They just kept doing it year after year. Those traditions run far deeper than any we have here. Well, today we come to the opening sentences of the Gospel of Matthew. And it's a tradition. That's what we see. A genealogy. Now, a genealogy is really just a series of stories. These people were real people in real times and real places, and real things happened to them. But in this particular case, we'll see that Matthew is doing something rather profound with these stories. Something that both includes and challenges their traditions and understandings of his people. And that I think we'll see challenge our own understandings and traditions as well. In verse 1, it opens with, "This is the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham." So I don't know if you guys learned this in school, but when I learned to read a book academically, the first question you're supposed to ask is, why is the author writing it? What's his point? What's his thesis? What's he trying to do with his work? And Matthew has done us a huge favor and just done it with the opening line, which is really generous, because if you look at the other three Gospels, you'll find that, well, Mark is in such a hurry to write his gospel, he never actually tells you why he's doing it. Luke gets it into the end of the first chapter. John does it at the end of the book. John. No, Matthew's done us a big favor. He gets his point out in the first sentence. He wants it right out in front. He wants you to know who Jesus is and where he came from. He's also doing some really clever wordplay. Really clever. So in the edition of the Bible that Matthew would have had, which would have been the Greek translation of the Old Testament, Genesis 1:1, actually the heading above it, has the Greek words genesis kosmoi, the beginning of the world. And genesis is where we get the word Genesis. So it was referred to as the Biblos Genesis, the book of the beginning. That's how they talked about the scroll of Genesis. You know what the first two words of the Gospel of Matthew are in Greek? Biblos Genesis. So Matthew is doing some, he's doing some like verbal jujitsu to get the people reading his work to say, oh, this is the book of Genesis. But this isn't the book of Genesis that we knew. This is Biblos Genesis Jesu Christu, the book of Genesis of Jesus Christ. So he's in a kind of shocking way forcing his readers to think about the creation of the world. But then he's saying, but not the creation you know. This is a new creation. You think you've heard the story of the beginning? Well, have I got a beginning for you? The genealogy of Jesus, the beginning, the genesis of Jesus Christ. So who is this Jesus? Oh, he's the Messiah. And here is another incredibly loaded word for the readers in the time of Matthew. Now, by the time of the first century, this character of the Messiah was extremely well known. Why? Well, because what happened at the end of Nehemiah, realizing that every kind of leader we've ever had, every prophet, every priest, every king, every political leader, every spiritual leader, all of them have eventually either crashed and burned, died, or thrown up their hands and said, I can't do this. But they knew there was a promise given that there would one day be someone who could do this. And they called that person the Messiah. It was their hope, the culmination of their hope, that there would be an heir to the promise to Adam and Eve of the one who would crush the serpent, that there would be an heir to the promise to Abraham to bless the nations of the world, the heir to the promise through Moses to send a prophet like him who would set his people free, the heir to the promise to David of an everlasting and righteous king who would reign forever, a superior prophet, a superior king, a superior priest, in a word, a savior. So when an early Jewish reader reads the word Messiah, they're going to get really excited. Really excited. This is the beginning of the story of the Messiah. Oh, and what else about this Jesus? He is the son of David, the son of Abraham. Just in case you missed the implications of that this is the Messiah, he will fulfill the promise to David that his descendant would sit on a throne in Jerusalem forever. And he's also the son of Abraham, who was called out of the place he was out of the place he was to a promised land and made a father of many nations. You're hearing this theme of beginnings? A new kind of king who will reign forever. A new kind of person called out to become the father of many nations. And you would think that after reading that first sentence, you'd be like, okay, the beginning of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham, now let's get on with what he does. And Matthew says, nope. Nope. First, Matthew is going to remind his readers of all the things that came in between Abraham and David. And then all the things that came between David and the exile. And then all the things that came between the exile and the coming of the Savior. And if you know any of this story, and I hope you do, and the readers of the first century definitely did, you can almost imagine a deep groan, because it's not a pretty story. You wouldn't think, can't we just talk about what comes next? Do we have to review our own ugly and broken history as God's people? Do we have to tell the story? Or can we just move on? Well, Matthew is not ready to move on. Now, perhaps there would actually be some others who would react the other way and say, ah, I knew it. All of this newfangled nonsense people are after is not where it's at. Our Messiah is actually, we're going to get our Messiah by going back to being like Abraham, being like David. And it will look exactly like it looked like for them. But neither of those are the case. And this, I think, is one of Matthew's major reasons for writing his gospel. See, Matthew understood something about human nature that we're just, I think we're just catching up with this now, at least in the American culture, that we have three natural bents when it comes to like determining identity and looking at the world and who we are and how we're supposed to be. On the one side, we have the traditionalist. Tradition! You know, Tevye singing at the start of Fiddler on the Roof in that first song. We look to the past. We reach back to the past to define ourselves. The first century audience here is the Pharisees. This group of people who looked solely to the traditions of the past in order to define how they were supposed to be in the present moment. And we have those today. People who look back to the golden age of how it used to be and say that's where we should look for authority and understanding who we are as human beings. And then there's the ultimate other side of it, which is those who would reject the past entirely and look solely to the future. In the first century, you would see that in probably the zealots, who say, we will sacrifice everything in the past to get a better future. And that didn't actually work out very well for them. If you know the story of Masada, the zealots didn't end well. But they're willing to sacrifice anything for a better tomorrow. And we have those people running around in our present culture too, who just don't really want to hear anything about an old and stodgy past, that are much more interested in just looking forward. Futurists, who are like, the only thing that matters is that we push forward into a new and better tomorrow. And then there are those who would look for the third way. Not rejecting tradition, but letting it evolve into a better future version. This approach to finding meaning and identity is often willing to compromise both the reality of the past and the hope of the future. This one often sounds very appealing, but once you dig into it, you realize what's happening is a rejection of what actually happened before. We're going to rewrite history so that it leads to a future we like, or compromising the possible hope of a future, saying we're only going to hope for this much, because we know our past doesn't let us get this. We rewrite the past to match a future vision and keep the vision small to preserve the past. In the first century, one might see this in the very pragmatic approach of the secularized Jewish Sadducees. We keep the law, but we see our rise to authority and power within the Roman Empire. And we have many of those running around our world today, who will use the past as an argument, but only insofar as it promotes their vision of the future. And it turns out, none of these are right. None of them. We will see in the Gospel of Matthew that Jesus confronts, disarms, and discards all three of these perspectives. Doing what recent social theorist Christopher Watkin calls diagonalization. He puts alternatives in rows and says, our world says you must choose one of these. Either you're a traditionalist, or you're a futurist, or you're a third way person. And Jesus shows up and he cuts across all three of them and says, there's a perspective you haven't even thought about. Taking alternatives, and rather than choosing one, critiquing all of them from an as-yet unrealized position. And Matthew does this through a story, through a tradition, through a culture. This genealogy, what precedes their future hope? Jacob? You know the story of Jacob? The dirty, sneaky thief who was always scheming how to get ahead, negotiated through his mother with his father, negotiated with God, schemed versus his cousin who turns out was just as sneaky as he was. That's not a particularly pretty picture. Or his son Judah? Judah, the tribe that led Israel? And yet what's called out here is the story of Judah and Tamar? I'm not going to go into that story here, but if you want to go read Genesis 36 and the story of Judah and Tamar, it's not good. Judah does not come off well. Or here, towards the end, you've got Salmon, the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab? Rahab, the Canaanite prostitute from Jericho? What is Matthew doing? He's subverting something in the way he's telling this genealogy. I mean, Boaz, the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth? Ruth, the Moabite refugee? Matthew is critiquing his own national story, saying, you guys, we're not who you think we are. We're not quite who you think we are. Jesus, the Messiah, the son of Abraham, the son of David, is also the son of Tamar, the Canaanite shepherdess, and Rahab, the Canaanite prostitute, and Ruth, the Moabite refugee. This story is a little bit of a mess. The story isn't perfect. It has issues. But this is the story. And the story isn't over yet. The traditions of Israel stand. They are what they are. The Old Testament remains scripture, remains authoritative. But they aren't everything. There is more yet to anticipate. The past matters, but it doesn't complete. There is more to anticipate. And that, friends, is the Advent season. The past stands. We celebrate the birth of Christ 2,000 years ago in a manger, laid in a manger. We can celebrate that, but if we get locked into the untrue statement that that is all there is, we won't have the future hope that God wants us to have. And by the same token, if we only look at the future hope and we don't face up to the past, we're going to have a very limited future. There is more to anticipate. We look back to the coming of Christ and all the promises kept in him and rightly celebrate it. We look forward to the coming of Christ and all the promises made for that day and rightly celebrate it. But it won't work unless we do both. One is never greater than the other. Friend, what kind of person are you? Consider, are you more likely to be drawn into the past and get stuck in wishing it was the way it used to be? Or are you obsessed with the future and the desire for something better than is now? Or are you trying to weave a third way where you would retell the story in a way that leads to the future you desire? Because as we study the Gospel of Matthew, we'll find that all of those are going to get cut to ribbons. Jesus shows up and he cuts across all of those perspectives and brings something dramatic and new and different that none of us would ever get to on our own. Jesus will be at the center of everything, turning all our identities towards what he says about who we are. Jesus will be at the center of everything, turning all our histories to a resurrection story. He will be at the center of everything, fulfilling all of our hopes in ways we could never imagine. It is my prayer for all of us that one day we will see with clear eyes that perspective that Jesus presents. That one day our prayers and our songs and our hearts will ring with true words. We're going to sing one last song, and then we'll have a moment of silence for reflection, and I'll read a benediction. This is a song you likely all know. It's the Hymn of Joy. The music is Ludwig van Beethoven, and the words were added a couple hundred years later. And I just want to call out one of the stanzas. Our celebration of joy is a turning of everything towards the one from whom the joy comes. All thy works with joy surround thee. Earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around thee. Center of unbroken praise. Who stands at the center? Outshines the sun. Is the center around all which all things orbit. The angels and the stars sing towards. The direction of all our praise is towards this Messiah, the humble baby in a manger, and the King of Kings forever. He is not one or the other. He is both forever.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. All thy works with joy surround thee. Earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around thee. Center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee. Thou art giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed. Wellspring of the joy of living, ocean depth of happy rest. Thou the Father, Christ our brother, All who live in love are thine. Teach us how to love each other. Lift us to the joy divine. Mortals join the mighty chorus, which the morning stars began. Father, love is reigning o'er us. Brother, love binds man to man. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music lifts us onward. Triumph songs of life.
Now the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness, and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. May we be eager to do what is good as God's own people. Amen.
If you found this video helpful or enriching to your life, you may find more of Cherry Grove Worship Services at the following link. If you wish to contact Cherry Grove Friends Church for more information, please contact our pastor, Mark Franklin. If you wish to leave a prayer request, go to our website and click on How Can We Pray For You?